So thanks, everybody. This is the final colloquium of the presentation of this semester. Yeah, and I'm actually very, very pleased to have the students from my quantitative research methods course present today. So they went on a very long journey from starting at the beginning of the semester, even though it's only 3 months, but they really started learning the very basics of scholarly research, research methods, how to design an experiment, how to do proper data management, how to plot it, how to analyze it. They actually ran, everybody ran a full experiment, and what you see today is the work from just 3 months. So I'm quite happy and quite proud to see what you guys have all accomplished. This is quite impressive, and without further ado, I hand it over, so make sure you... Here. Oh yeah, one more announcement. Tonight at 6 o'clock, we will have a kind of mixed methods brew pub mingler for all the 802 and 801 students. We meet at 6 in the brew pub. When you enter, just before the reception, just go directly to the right there, and we'll be there.
How is that for level? Can you guys hear me? Okay. So just 1 second. All right, let me know when I can go. Hi, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Elgin McLaren. I'm a master's student here, and I'm working with Dr. Antle. So I'd like to start off today by just asking you to reflect on your own experiences and think about a time when maybe you were feeling stressed or nervous. And I want you to think about how that felt for your body and what that was like in your mind. Did you find it hard to focus? Did you find that your mind was really wandering or racing? And then when that happened, did you find that it was making your stress even worse? So if you haven't had this experience, then that's not uncommon at all. It happens to everyone because stress and attention are very closely related. And that's why one way that we can effectively manage any attentional issues we have and we can improve our attention is through the use of self-regulation. So by self-regulation, what I'm referring to is deep breathing, inward focus, and meditation. But if any of you have ever tried to meditate, you'll know that it's really hard to get started. So my supervisor, Dr. Antle, here at SIAT, as well as other researchers, have found that using neurofeedback-based devices are actually very helpful for helping people learn to acquire these self-regulation skills. This is an example of the one that we use in our lab and the one that we actually use in this study. And the way that it works is that you've got a single sensor EEG that you wear on your head, and it measures brainwaves that are related to attention. And when you reach a certain threshold, what that does is it triggers this animation, which gives you a visual feedback of whether or not you're focusing. Now, a lot of current research that has been done has been focused on the use of these sorts of systems over a longer period of time, say several weeks. But what I was interested for my project in looking at was more of the immediate effect of using a neurofeedback-based system. Now, obviously, you're not going to learn how to self-regulate in one day. That's not very realistic. But I was wondering, does using a neurofeedback-based game, like Mindful, cue a user's attentional abilities that may already be inside of them, that may already be pre-existing? So when I talk about attention, I just wanted to clarify that there are several different types of attention, and I'm looking specifically at sustained attention. So that's what you guys are doing right now, actually, paying attention to me over a period of time. So my hypothesis was that participants who spend 10 minutes using the mindful neurofeedback-based attention game will perform better on a test of sustained attention than participants who observe the game without neurofeedback connected. Now, this is sort of the flow that people went through, but I'll just kind of walk you through very briefly. I had 23 participants, and it was a between groups design. So the participants were randomly assigned to either the neurofeedback group or the control group. So the neurofeedback group actually was controlling what they saw on the screen. The control group, on the other hand, was watching a screen capture of someone else having played it. So they actually had no control over that at all, although we did not tell them that that was the case. In fact, we didn't tell either group whether they can control it. We just asked them to try their hardest to see if they could. And then the other things that I wanted to draw your attention to here, other than the independent variable of the neurofeedback, is these two sustained attention tests, which happen pre and post the treatment. And those were used, I did it twice so that there'd be a baseline. So they start off doing it once, we did the treatment, and then we looked at the results of the second time to see if there was a difference between the groups. So the dependent variables that I had were the results from these attention tasks, the brainwave data for the entire hour-long session, as well as some self-report surveys that they filled out along the way. So this is a little bit of a preview of what the sustained attention result task looks like. So this takes place for about 5 minutes, and the user is looking for a target number, and every time they see a number that is not the target number, they need to press the space bar. And this allows us to measure errors of omission as well as errors of commission. And we also looked at the brainwave data. But the errors of omission and commission mean that you really have to be focused. If your mind wanders, you'll get behind. If you get stressed out, you'll get behind. And people were reacting as they did this activity. They would kind of like groan when they wouldn't actually get the numbers correct. So here's a little bit of just a snapshot of the data. This is the raw plot, so it hasn't been divided up by treatments. And I would expect that if my hypothesis is correct, that when I apply the treatment, the difference between the post-test for the two different groups would be different. Unfortunately, that is not the case. There is no evidence to support my hypothesis as being correct. In fact, there didn't appear to be any significant difference between the two groups when I ran them through some post-hoc tests. However, this could be because it was a very small sample size. Maybe this would become a bit more clear if I had more people in my groups. So I'm not losing out hope yet. I do still have the brainwave data, and I'm still really, like, there's a lot of data entry, or there's like thousands of entries for each person. Is that 5 or 5:30? Oh, shoot. Well, anyways, brainwave data is coming. And there is some hope because the treatment group actually did seem to have more attention during the game itself. So this is something I want to further explore and kind of break it down more into different groups so we can explore the actual differences. And that is all. Voila.
Where? F5? All right. Yep. So I'm Jeff, and I'm going to talk about complexity and music similarity. So in general, I'm interested in developing algorithms which will do stylistic imitation of music. So that's the overall goal. And this kind of builds towards that, just a small step towards that. So that begs the question, what is style? And what makes music stylistically similar? Similarity forms the basis for genres and for cohesion within a musical piece itself. And that's how we understand it when we listen to it. So it's very important, if we're aiming to create music, we need to really understand how similarity functions. And that's still a big open problem in this field. So most previous work has aimed to show that maybe a particular dimension has a greater role of significance in making similarity judgments. Some people will say maybe contour has a more prominent role, or other people maybe say rhythm does. But recently, people have kind of brought up the point of view that maybe the musical content itself actually creates a different similarity criteria. So my research question was, how does musical content create a criteria for these similarity judgments? And more specifically, does the relative complexity of pitch content and rhythm content affect similarity perception?
So my hypothesis was that modifications to the low complexity dimension would decrease perceived similarity to a greater extent than modifications to the high complexity dimension, relatively speaking. So here's an example of one of the melodies that was used. We see the pitch content up top and the rhythm content on the bottom. So we have low complexity in the pitch dimension, as you see a repeated pattern AAB, and high complexity in the rhythm dimension, where we have three distinct patterns. So it's kind of difficult to actually get any sense of cohesion there. So the entire experiment had three factors, two different levels of pitch complexity, two different levels of rhythm complexity, and two different scale types, the pentatonic and the whole tone scale. So now we can listen to some of the melodies. Here's an example of low rhythm complexity and low pitch complexity. So we see the sequences over there. And here's another version. And here's the most complex one, where we have complexity in both dimensions. So ultimately speaking, there's obviously a vast possibility of what could be considered complex and what could be considered simple, but I wanted to keep this within a reasonable domain of what people usually listen to. So for each prototype melody, of which there were eight, given the 2x2x2 design, there's two modified versions of the melody. I modified the rhythm in one version and the pitch in another. And each participant was presented with this. The prototype melody, and then a randomized, either the rhythm was here or there, and they were asked to rate the similarity of melody A to the prototype and the similarity of melody B to the prototype on a scale from 1 to 20. So my dependent variable was simply the difference between these two similarity ratings. What was the similarity of the modified rhythm version, and what was the similarity of the modified pitch version? And the results that I found are showed here. So higher values mean that the rhythm modified version is more similar, and lower values mean that the pitch modified version is more similar. So we see here when the rhythm and pitch are relatively similar, so either they're both simple or they're both complex, we see that it's basically even. It's a little bit skewed towards the rhythm modified version, but you can see they're both the same here and here. However, when there's there's a difference in relative complexity, so when we have complex rhythm but simple pitch, it moves towards the high complexity dimension. And when we have high complexity pitch and low complexity rhythm, it moves towards the pitch. Once again, the higher complexity dimension, which proves my hypothesis. So I had 51 participants, and I found that both the main effect of rhythm and the main effect of pitch complexity was significant, which is exactly what I was aiming for. There were no interactions, which makes sense because, yeah. And interestingly, there was no significant effect of scale type. So there was no difference between whole tone and pentatonic, which actually surprised me. I thought there was going to be a difference. So why is this important? Well, it proved my hypothesis, and it begins to explain how humans establish a similarity criteria based on the musical content. And it's evidence that dimensional complexity affects similarity judgments. And we can develop generative systems that take this observation into account, resulting in improved style imitation.
need new glasses. There we go. Okay. So I'm Arron Ferguson. I'm going to present Behind the Curtain, Does Character Consistency and the Tragedy After Ethical Choices Have Any Sort of Matter in Interactive Narrative? And so my hypothesis with this was that users of interactive narrative will find that there's an increase in engagement levels if there's tragedy ending at the end of an ethical decision. On the flip side of things, I was hypothesizing that if engagement levels, or rather the character inconsistency, would drop the engagement levels. So why is this important? Well, the games industry last year, $91.5 billion spent on it. There's increasingly open world games that are coming out, and players want more than just simply interacting with stuff. They want more than that. They want more than branch paths. They want more than, and we're at this level now, the multiple endings. We're heading towards the ultimate goal of having open story to match the open world. As far as what it means to me, well, I like narrative. I like to write. I also like a good story when I'm playing a video game of sorts. So my methods were, I used different conditions, repeated measures, experiments. There were three different types of story. That was my independent variable. And all of them had interaction. All of them had some sort of an ethical choice to make. That was the control. The inconsistent character would be so that one of the characters would maybe be mean or maybe be polite in between different parts of the story. And the one with tragedy, somebody would either be seriously hurt or die based on the decision. And the way it worked was either way you had something happen like a tragedy. 173 participants with 519 ratings. Each rating, three narratives, so those are the treatments. And I used a rating ratio scale from 0 to 10, 0 being completely disinterested, no engagement whatsoever, 10 being completely engaged. So the methods were, web app was an interactive web app, and participants would enter an access code. So I had groups that had different access codes. They would read, and they'd make some choices within the narrative, and then they'd read the story. They'd do that two times more. There were between 5 and 7 pages for the stories, and approximately 5 minutes for each story, so about 15 minutes to do the whole thing. And so the results were insignificant. I know, right? Like really insignificant, like standard deviation. I was staring at this thinking, hey, maybe I did something wrong here, but no. So what I did was I took a look at maybe one of the stories. Nope, no significance. Story 2, no significance. Story 3, no significance. And I even took a look at the access codes to see maybe one of the groups, you know, rogue group, students, college students, right? College computing students maybe having some fun with me. No significance. So this was me last week, right? It should have worked. It felt like it worked. The science seemed so solid. But I think I can explain, or at least what I think the reason why this happened, by turning to classical Sesame Street with children talking to a puppet. Yeah, look at the eye contact. Okay, they're eye contact. They're too young to act. That's not what that is. So what are they doing? And by the way, do you think that they don't see the puppeteer underneath? It was Jim Henson. He was 6'3", Bernhard's height, except big bushy beard. You couldn't miss him. So what was it, right? Well, it's that they wanted to interact with the narrative. They wanted to believe. They wanted Kermit the Frog to be real, okay? And we do this as adults all the time, okay? We watch, you know, for example, Star Wars Episode 4, 1977, A New Hope, right? It's riddled with continuity errors, gaping plot holes, right? Well, there goes another one. Hold your fire. It's an escape pod. Shoot the damn thing, right? I mean, hello? Are you trying to conserve lasers or something? We don't care. We don't care. We want the narrative. And why? Because we want to see Luke Skywalker avenge his, avenge his aunt and his uncle's death, fly down that Death Star, and boom, blow up the Death Star. Right? So as storytellers, we have a huge amount of flexibility with this. Character inconsistency is tolerable. Okay? We can get away as storytellers. Likewise, tragedy. Whether or not there's tragedy at the end of some sort of a moral dilemma or ethical decision made, doesn't matter. It's the fact that he got to play. And so as storytellers, I hope this is something that you can take away with and use in later times with projects that you might have in later courses and so on. Thank you for your time.
Hello everyone, I'm Ming. So my study focus on how to move in virtual realities. So, but before we start, let me summarize the current situation of VR in just one sentence. That is, virtual reality is virtually borderless, but really restricted. But why do I say that? The problem is, after you cover your head with a head-mounted display, an infinite virtual world appear in your eyes, and you can be embedded in various simulations created in VR. That's why I say that virtuality is virtually borderless. But can you always physically walk or run from one point to another point in VR? No, you can't do that. You are restricted. You are restricted by surrounding things in the real world so that you cannot freely move. You don't want to hit your computer or your chair or your table while playing VR games, and you shouldn't go out that area. And one popular solution for that limitation is passive movement. That means you can only travel along a redefined trajectory with designated speed and acceleration. You don't like this style of movement if you want to freely explore the environment. Another popular solution is teleportation. You use a joystick to point to a position and then you immediately appear at that position. Of course, it's unnatural, so that you may be completely disoriented after a long chain of teleportation. So, what I am trying to do here is to propose a new navigation technique in VR. That means I propose some navigation techniques and compare the user performance and comfortability between those techniques so that I can give precise comparison to confirm the superiority of a navigation. By using that navigation, I can reduce motion sickness and enhance user comfortability and experience. So let's talk about our techniques. So the first one is the fixed reference navigation. That means that the idea of this navigation comes from the ideas of classic 2D game. That means you can only go forward in one fixed direction. In one fixed direction, when you press the forward button, then regardless of your head rotation and body rotation, you always go forward in one fixed direction. So the second navigation technique is head-based navigation. VR system nowadays include tracking camera and sensor so that it can track your head rotation and position. So head can be used as a navigator. And when you press the forward button, so you move forward in your head direction. And the last technique is body-based navigation. It's much similar to the various one, but now your body is used as a navigator. So you can rotate your head freely and you go in your body direction. So my research question is, which technique is the best in terms of user performance and comfortability? And I do expect that body-based navigation would be the best one because it imitates human behavior in the real world when you can go straight ahead and look around. But who knows? So the participants need to do a searching task in the virtual world. They need to find a ball hidden in 16 boxes randomly positioned and rotated. So the user effort to move and rotate. And I measure some independent variable. The first one is completion time and travel distance that describes the performance, and head rotation and body rotation, that I call technical comfortability. That means if they rotate a little, so they spend less energy and they feel more comfortable. And the final one is user evaluation. That means user rating for learning, movement, and comfortability. So that's, this is the result. So you can see that, that the fixed referent navigation give the walk result. So I don't mention it anymore. Just compare the headspace navigation and bodyspace navigation. So in performance of user in headspace navigation is slightly better than bodyspace navigation. When they travel shorter and spend less time. And the same thing happened for the technical comfortability. That means in this result that participants spend less energy on rotating in headspace navigation. And user evaluation confirmed the superior of the headspace navigation. When they feel more comfortable with headspace navigation, it's easier to learn, easier to move, and it, they feel more comfortable with headspace navigation. So my hypothesis become wrong. What happened? It may be, so look at here, you can see that in headspace navigation, they own your, their head, the participant head and body direction are always the same. Why they expect them to go ahead and look around, but they don't do that? It may be because in my interface, when they, when their body direction in this direction, they want to move in that direction, they can press the joystick to go to the left, but it go like this. But in the real world, we go like this. We rotate your body first and then move. So that may be a problem. So what can I do about my reason? So this is my conclusion. Has your own way your best navigator, both literally and metaphorically, in both real world and virtual world. That's it. Oh, sorry.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ri Pan, and today I'm going to present my project Split Horizontal Overlapped, comparing social presence and body ownership in shared video views for couples. But before I start, I want to ask a quick question to you guys. Do you ever want to have the feeling of seeing through your partner's eyes? I can help you get that feeling. So a short introduction of the backgrounds. The popularity of computer-mediated communication like video chatting provides us a means to connecting friends and family members over distance. Most of the existing video chatting apps are focusing on talking head settings, so no matter it's a Skype or FaceTime or Google Hangouts, it's all kind of a simulation of face-to-face communications. However, researchers have seen, has been coming out new systems to fit in new contexts like sharing activities. For example, a parallel first-person view sharing is designed for supporting the co-located group collaborations. So we were wondering, how could we use the first-person view, this idea, to explore this first person view could have an impact on the relationship maintenance for couples over distance. So to be more specifically, I have these two research questions here. Which interface of the first person sharing view can have stronger feeling of social presence for couples? The second research question is, which interface of the shared views can help couples gain more body ownership of their partners? To answer these two research questions, I have the following system designs. I designed this system prop called a Ghost Partner with Google Cardboard and smartphones. We also developed a WebRTC-based video chatting app with the systems. Correspondingly, we also designed three different kind of interface with this Google with this Ghost Partner technology prop. The first one is called Split View. Basically, your left eye and your right eye see different views. And second one is a horizontal view, like your side and your partner's like stacking together. And third one, we call it overlap view. Basically, we merge the two sides in the same frame. To compare these three interfaces, we recruit 10 pairs of participants. So our sample size is 20, and four of them already got married. One of the participants are homosexual couples, and the age range is from 21 to 23. So we put our participants in two separate rooms located in two different floors. You can see from the photo, the settings in the room is pretty much similar. So we had a heart-shaped sticker on the wall, we had a chair, we had a left, we had a table on that, and it's an iPad with Skype on, and a mirror in it. So We sent through our instructions through the Skype speaker because to eliminate the observer effect, we are not actually in the rooms. So the first task we asked the participant to do to align the heart shape on the wall. And the second task we asked them to do to shape some three English letters with their hands with their partners. And third one is to stroke their arms with their right hand synchronously and gently with their partner. So after doing the three tasks, we allow them to play with the interface freely for 3 minutes and ask them the following questionnaires. So the independent variables in my study is the interface style. So we have split view, horizontal, overlay as three levels here. And for dependent variables, it's the responses to questionnaire related to social presence and body ownerships. This is a non-parametric one-way repeated measures. We use a Friedman test and a wear cognitive sign part ranks as the post hocs. Our result here, so we broke down social presence in six subcategories: connectedness, difficulty, synchronization, and etc. So we found, in terms of the feeling of connectedness, we found overlap view has a higher score than split view. And in terms of the feeling of isolations, the overlap view has a lower score than the horizontal view. But interestingly, in mutual understandings, horizontal view has a higher score among the threes. So in terms of body ownership, we did the same things. In terms of the feeling of seeing through partner's eyes, we found that the overlapped view has a higher score than the split view in terms of the heart feeling I'm seeing through my partner's eyes. And in terms of feeling of hand transition, means like I feel my hand has changed my partner's hand, the split view has a higher score than the horizontal view. And the feeling of I have more hands in my body, the overlapped view has a higher score than the horizontal one. So in the end, I want to summarize my study to this quick takeaway messages. So we designed a new video chat system for sharing first-person view for couples. A quantitative study shows that the overlap view and the split view provide more connectedness and body ownership, and as well as less feeling of isolated. However, the horizontal view provides more mutual understanding but less body ownership. Thank you.
Testing. That sounds all right. Hi, everybody. My name is Denise, and today I'm here to awe you. So a lot of people have probably experienced awe before. It's a complex emotion, something that's difficult to quantify. It is made up of wonder, curiosity, humility, feelings of being moved. So this is something that we want to study. Right now, a lot of virtual reality content draws its inspiration from cinematic techniques. Problem with a lot of cinematic techniques, they took 100 plus years to develop, and it developed for this flat screen. With virtual reality content, people are experimenting with multi-sensory stimuli, and a lot of this is extremely experimental. Also, a lot of the research that's previously been done into lasting impact with stories, narratives, and awe has been concentrated on audio finding. So having people listen to music and experience chills, or the aspect of being awed, feelings of being moved, has been done with audio content. And other research has actually found that goosebumps are strongly tied to awe. So this is interesting, because it is, in fact, an objective measure whether somebody experiences goosebumps or not. If you receive them, it's been found that with previous research, goosebumps are actually second to feeling cold in terms of their occurrence and why they occur. And that's because of awe. So with VR being seen as a strong feelings vehicle or vehicle for emotion, that makes it an excellent medium to concentrate on and try and measure with different positive emotion attributes. So the research question here is, can immersive VR content provoke feelings of awe that can be measured both objectively and subjectively? And in order to measure this, we selected goosebumps, so optic recordings of whether or not people receive goosebumps, and EEG brain states to look for synchrony between participants. Another question is, does the kind of interaction, so flying or standing, actually impact their feelings of awe also? And finally, do traits within their personality, such as openness to experience and immersive tendencies, have any impact on whether or not people feel and experience awe? So the hypothesis was that immersive VR does in fact generate this emotion, that openness to experience, as with previous studies, will impact the effector, and that high ratings of the immersive tendencies questionnaire for participants will actually have a correlation with high incidence of awe. So the experiment was four conditions. So either people experienced Vancouver or Tibet, flying or standing, and this was counterbalanced so that we had an equal opportunity for everybody to experience both. Regardless of whether they started with Vancouver or Mount Everest, they all experienced a 5-minute tour with no interactivity, no controllers to get used to VR, and they concluded with a 5-minute tour of a place of their choice. After each of the conditions, they participated in a survey about their feelings. So here's some initial findings. This is data for 15 participants. There were 16 total. So females had a slight tendency to report awe, more than males did. So that actually is in line with previous research, that females are a bit more sensitive to the awe effect. Also found that in terms of the awe-o-meter, so the awe self-reports, that those who reported the sensation of having chills also reported their awe as higher. So there is some sort of connection between the sensation of chills and those who felt that they actually experienced awe. Now, in terms of personality, this was a little bit interesting because openness to experience as a five-factor personality trait actually had very little effect. And in fact, neuroticism, which is the one on the very end there, the fifth, that had a slight effect in terms of whether or not it could predict somebody's experience of awe ratings. So in terms of the chill sensation and those who felt they experienced awe and had experienced chills, it did have a tendency that they would have more reports of being immersive or have an immersive tendency style personality. Although the effect isn't that strong, there's a very slight correlation between those who experience chills and awe and those who actually do have a high immersive tendencies personality. And finally, the EEG brain frequencies are still being processed. What we're looking for here is some synchrony among the user's brain states and breaking down their total session time. So this is participant with their first session and their second session. And we're looking between participants to see if there's any sort of correlation between their activity and what they experience. And finally, the actual goosebump effect, optic recordings are going to be measured. I can say anecdotally that there have been goosebumps found within the actual imagery itself. Whether or not they're experiencing a lot is to be seen still. So thank you very much.
My name is Amelia Cole, and I'm really focused on stress. And one of the main things that we know about stress is that long-term exposure or chronic stress actually can impair our cognitive abilities and has a significant impact on our health. Basically, the more stressed you are continuously, the more likely it is that you're going to become sick. And so what I want to do is to build self-regulation tools that help people who have anxiety or stress-related issues better control their emotions. And we can do this by looking at three distinct fields. So both psychology and neuroscience are great intersections with technology to develop therapeutic programs that not only address someone's psychological state, but also look at the measures and how we can better inform people about their coping mechanisms. So what we've done is, Mindful is an application that's developed out of this TECI lab under Dr. Antle, and it is a brain-computer interface that interacts with a tablet that produces an animation on screen that's manipulated based on our neural activity. So it comes in two states. It measures whether you're essentially relaxed or stressed. And what I wanted to understand was whether or not EEG neurofeedback can actually work in the short term to reduce a person's response to stress. And so I've created an experimental design in which I looked at two different conditions and randomly allocated participants to either the neurofeedback condition or the video condition. And the video condition was like sham neurofeedback. It was basically a video recording of someone else playing the mindful game. Also, I put in three separate events. One was a baseline to establish how someone was feeling or their brain activity at the beginning. A meditative event where we looked at 10 minutes worth of time spent meditating, and then a stress event, which was a math test, which is in literature shown to produce a stressful response. And so I, throughout the measures, I used EEG brainwaves continuously throughout the entire experiment, as well as did some self-report surveys using validated scales for stress. Now, the results, there are no significant differences for self-report in any of the factors. And for neurological, the EEG readings, there was no significant difference between the groups. However, I did find that I stressed them out with math, so that's positive. So what does this all mean? So EEG can either not work in the short term, meaning we should use it for continuous use, or otherwise participants, at the end, we gave them a debrief, and we asked them to give a percent allocation to how much control they felt they had over the on-screen object. And it varied greatly between 20% and 80%, and there were no real differences between the treatment or control groups. And so what this may point to is that, at least for adults, we may need to look at redesigning the system in order to create more immediacy and make it less binary, not relaxed and stressed, but more fluid, detecting the neural activity. So I end with a question of, can we actually detect those subtle differences in neural activity and display them and represent them on screen?
I'm Al Misuri, and my presentation is about, do you want to start from scratch, or will visual tracking your visual history, your what you're doing through analysis will help you improve your performance? So the visual tracking, why I'm doing this, why this project is. So we have a lot of huge amount of data, and if we try to like to understand something of numbers and numbers, that doesn't make sense. So what we try to do now is visualize it, try to understand, get some pattern here, using charts, data, and all that. However, still we have to understand that to make that data efficiently, we need to minimize the effort, or we will spend a lot of charts and that, try to analyze where to start from and where I'm going through. So what we can do is to keep track of what we are doing and keeping track of that visual analysis process. So what we are starting to implement, what I did is a system that allows you to create charts dynamically. It's called dynamic dashboards. You have like a video in here. So you can generate the charts dynamically, filter and select, see the interaction through that, drill down to details, creating new charts, different dimensions, and drag and drop interaction. An easy interaction that allows you to go through your data, try to analyze it in more details. And as you see, whatever you do here is tracked through the history, which you can later on grab back into the analysis and instead of redoing everything from start. So my hypothesis was, will user perform better in a visual analytic task using a system that analyzes their track this their interaction or not? So what I did is I have two systems, a dynamic dashboard system that has history in it and a system that doesn't have a history panel in it. The same interaction, the difference is that the history panel. And I have my settings as repeated measures experiment where the user are given the two systems, given two different tasks on two different data sets. They are comparable tasks, by the way. They answer questions about the data using the system. And I change the orders for the different participants, so I have two orders. First, either I give them the baseline first, or I give them the dynamic dashboard first. What I'm measuring from them is the time to complete each task for each data set, and some usability question, how easy it is to use each task. And I'm logging the actions they are doing and screen recording to actually analyze that later, how they are using the system. So what happened? So I have 8 participants. So because of the two ways, I'm using a two ways measured ANOVA and treating the order of execution as one of my independent variables. The other independent variable is the system itself, baseline or dynamic dashboards, and some qualitative methods of analyzing the feedback I got from the users. So what happens? So these are the times, the result overview over time. So when I start with dynamic dashboards, the second system is always better. So this, which means that they needed time to actually use the system. So when I started with dynamic dashboard first, the baseline was a bit, they had less time to, was more efficient. And when I started with the baseline, the dynamic dashboard was useless time. Which means that the order of presenting the system was more important than actual the system. However, still, it seems that starting with the baseline, the dynamic dashboard is more efficient, even like the difference between these two are more if we started with the baseline. The analysis of the statistical of that shows that the order of experiment was significant. I guess I did something here to make it okay. This, however, the interaction between two was not that much of significant. The order of this is the interaction diagram, which sees that the different order of experiment was actually makes a difference in these systems. For the usability, for the result of the usability, there is actually no significant difference between the two systems. A little bit of small, a very small difference in here. So what happens? So they are easy to use. The system, the participant found the system easy to use, but they wanted to start from scratch. There were less use of history. However, they are not using it as much as I expected. So why I expected that they need too quick to redo things, and it's easier to do that from history to reducing than start from scratch. However, they needed more training, and my next step is to do more analysis and understand that better and modify methods. Thank you.
Okay, I'm Duc-Minh, and today I will introduce my project in virtual reality. In our daily life, sometimes we can get lost in large and strange areas. For example, in a mall, in a park, or in an airport. It happens more often in virtual reality where we cover our head with an HMD. We have no idea about our physical world. Our spatial orientation is now manipulated mostly by our vision. Let's look at the box on the screen, and now we will rotate a little bit. After the rotation, please help me to identify if it's, the box is on your left, your right, or behind you. Okay, who thinks it's on your left? Your right? Behind you? Okay, let's do it again, but this time we are standing at the center of a rectangular box. Is it much easier now? Yeah, the idea is simply to add a rectangular box into the virtual environment so that as a reference frame, so that participants can refer it to have more spatial orientation. This idea derived from the cave with a classic virtual environment that unintentionally provides hints of direction by its edges and corners. My research question is, do reference frames improve user performance in spatial orientation tasks in VR, and do reference frames have user to reduce their spatial disorientation and make them feel more comfortable? I have three conditions. The no reference frame is the control condition without any visual cue, and the simulated case is the condition where the reference frame moves with user but doesn't rotate with them. The simulated room is the condition where the reference frame is bigger, stationary, and totally independent of user movement. In my study, I use STC via SMD at the visual interface and the Navi chair at the locomotion interface. When you sit on, what's wrong with this? When you sit on the Navi chair, you can lean and rotate in any direction to navigate. I have the video to the most, but it's a little left. And in the game, we have A bones hidden in sitting boxes, and the task for participants is to find all A bones in the most effective way. In the experiment, users have a chance to get familiar with the interface, especially the Navi chair, in the training session. After that, they have three trials relevant to three conditions to do the main experiment and then the evaluation for each condition. At the end of the study, we have the briefing session to ask participants more about their experience, the difficulty they have met, and the strategy that they use to find on A bones. Because this is a repeated measure experiment, every participant took part in all three conditions, and I have six groups relevant to six order of condition. Participants were sort of randomly assigned to this group, and this is the result. Fortunately, it was significant. The completion time is the first considerable variable. People who have good spatial orientation can complete the time in a shorter, can complete the task in a shorter time, and ANOVA revealed that simulated room significantly helps participants to reduce their completion time. Another relevant variable is the travel distance, because the task is to find all A points in the most effective way. Participants who have good spatial orientation can plan their strategy to visit and find all A points in the structure bus, and the results show that simulated room also significantly help participants reduce their travel distance. Last but not least, the revisit is variable to represent the amount of spatial disorientation. People who lack sense of direction tend to revisit own bosses a lot, and the results show that participants significantly had less box revisit when using the simulated room. The results show that, in conclusion, the proposed visual cue have significant effect on user performance in VR, and moreover, the stationary reference frame can help them can produce user more spatial orientation than the moving one. So if you are a designer or researcher who working in VR, just keep in mind that adding a box in your visual scene can significantly improve your user performance. Thank you for listening.
Hello everyone, my name is Fatima and I'm a PhD student. I'm working on e-learning. By the emergence of the e-learning, the use of the online discussion is increased. Unlike the class discussion, online discussion is an asynchronous mode, and then you cannot and then you cannot contact with your other classmates. Writing is also time-consuming and can't transfer or convey the tone of the conversations. The delays between the responses also weaken the discussions. With all of these reasons, it is necessary to provide feedbacks for students to be motivated and informed in online discussions. So we implemented three types of visual feedbacks for Canvas. The first one is a class average that you can compare the quantity of your post with the class average. And then the other one is a top contributor visualization that showed the students the top contributors in terms of the quantity of their posts. And then the last one is a post quality visualization, which focuses on the content of the post and computed the quality of the post by the text analysis toolkit software called Similar. I put forward two research questions. The first one is how these three types of visual feedback affect the students' quality of the post with different learning styles, and the other one is how these types of visual feedback affect the students' quantity of the post with different learning styles. So we have to determine a student's learning style. A student approach to learning has two components. The first one is motive, which answers the question of why the student approach to learning. And the other one is a strategy that answers the question of how the student approach to learning. There is a standard questionnaire called the study process questionnaire, SFQ, which measures these characteristics, and the value is continuous, but if it is negative, it shows that the student is a surface learner with the fear of the failure, and if it is positive, the student is a deep learner with intrinsic interest. I have three hypotheses. The first one is a hypothesis that there is a strong association between the types of the visual feedbacks and also a students' performance controlled by their learning styles, and also deep learners have a higher post quality by viewing quality visualization, and surface learners have a higher post quantity by viewing class average visualization. So we assigned one type of visualization to each student. We have 108 participants, and then we'll log all in students' interactions in online discussions. And then we use this self-report SPQ questionnaires to identify learning styles of the students. And finally, I use the ANCOVA to analyze these data with this type of visualization as independent variables, and these two, quality and quantity of the posts, as a dependent variables, which controlled by the learning styles as a covariate. This is the results of ANCOVA, and unfortunately, the result is not significant, but it shows that the quality visualization has a better effect rather than others on the quality of the post. In the next one, you can see that, again, it's not significant, but the class average visualization has a better effect on the quantity of the post in online discussions. In this plot, I want to show you the correlation between the average post quality and learning approach in different visual feedback types, and you can see that there is a correlation in quality visualization, and it shows that the surface learners has a better quality of the post when they view this quality visualization. In the next plot, I show you the correlation between the post quantity and learning approach in different types of visual feedbacks, and you can see that there is a correlation in the class average visualization, and then you can see that the deep learners has more posts in online discussions when they are viewing average visualization. To sum up, the effects of visual feedbacks on a student's performance, both quality and quantity of the posts controlled by their learning styles, is not significant. On the contrary of my assumptions, quality visualization has a stronger effect on surface learners' quality of the post, and also class average visualization has a stronger effect on deep learners' quantity of the post. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Junwei. The topic of my talk is assessing input methods and cursor displays for 3D positioning with HMDs. So this is a head-mounted display or an HMD. So if you are playing a game, playing a VR game wearing the HMD, what input method would you prefer if you want to position one object from one position to another? Like you always encountered these thoughts in your VR games. So you may answer that, it's the controller, right? But actually, after my talk, you may reconsider your answer. So basically, my motivation is to find a proper input method and cursor display for precise 3D positioning in the HMDs. So this could help VR researchers and game designers to with 3D positioning with their research, modeling, or game design. So specifically, what I want to find out is which input method provides better accuracy and efficiency for 3D positioning in the HMDs, and which cursor display provides better efficiency and accuracy for 3D positioning in HMDs. And also, I want to figure out which one does the user like the most. So in my study, I will be using STC Vive, but the results can be generalized to other HMDs. So I'm using two main independent variables, the input method and the cursor display. For the input method, there are three levels, the mouse, the hand tracking with the controller, and trackpad with the controller. The cursor display has two levels, the stereo cursor and the one-eyed cursor. With the stereo cursor, the user can see the cursor in both eyes. With one-eyed cursor, the user can only see the cursor in the dominant eye. So this is a picture of a user using the system with the mouse. So as you can see, the user is sitting in front of a desk. So we actually calibrated the room, the virtual room, so that the user can use the system while he or she is sitting down. So basically, this is mouse condition. The second condition is hand tracking. So basically, with hand tracking, we track the hand position and use the rotation of the controller to move the object like this. The third condition is the trackpad. So on the HTC Vive controller, there's a circle trackpad, and the user can just touch the trackpad and move the object with the trackpad, with the thumb. For the experimental task, I also have two more independent variables, the surface of the scene and the object density. The surface has two levels, flat surface and curved surface. Object density has another two levels, empty and cluttered. So here are the sample tasks for the four combinations. Starting on the bottom, on the top, there are, on the top, these are flat surfaces, flat with empty scene, flat with cluttered scene, and curved surface with empty scene, curved surface with cluttered scene. So for independent variables, I'm measuring completion time, error distance, and the questionnaires answered by the users. The experiment design, I used 12 participants. I have a 3x2x2x2 within subject design. So for each condition, there will be 5 trials. So for each participant, there will be like 120 trials. So here's the result for time. We found significance of input method on time. So basically, the mouse in the middle is faster than hand tracking, and hand tracking is faster than trackpad. And for cursor display, we didn't find a significant effect. So this is the results for error. So again, we found significant effect of input method on error. So the mouse is, again, significantly more accurate than the trackpad. But hand tracking is not significantly different from either the mouse or trackpad. And again, we didn't find a significant difference of cursor display on error. So in conclusion, the mouse was the most efficient and accurate for 3D positioning in HMDs, because the hand track and user prefer the mouse the best. So with the hand tracking, it requires more hand movement, and it provides more fatigue, and the hand jitter really affects the result. And for the trackpad, it's really hard to use the thumb on such a small control space. And cursor display was not significant, yet the stereo cursor was preferred by the user because it's more comfortable. If you cannot use the system while sitting down, there is an alternative, which is to use hand tracking for non-precise positioning and transition to trackpad for fine adjustment. Thank you very much.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for having me to present for you. I want to present my research on evaluating effectiveness of multi-DNA alternatives in design tasks. So I want to start my presentation by asking you just a question. What if I give you these two black pencils and ask you to draw the whole this drawing with the whole colors with just these two black pencils? You would absolutely react like this, because how on earth somebody can make something without having appropriate tool to do it? This is what exactly designers and architects go through in their design tasks. They don't have appropriate medium, and we ask them to make visually and functionally pleasing models. So how do designers start their design is creating lots and lots of alternatives. And what I mean by making alternatives is, for example, when you want to design a cell phone, you have a thousand and hundreds of options. So the first option you have is your first alternative. These are some kinds of architectural alternatives I made in my BS. So what kind of computer-aided design tools we have to support architects' creative tasks? Almost all of the interfaces we have for architects are single-state interfaces, which just let the users to work on just one model at a time. So when someone wants to make 100 alternatives, they have to make 100 files. So when they want to compare them, they have to open 100 files and go back and forth in them, through them to compare them. Also, they're not able to make changes when they have 100 alternatives with some common parameters in them. So an answer for this is subjunctive interfaces, which lets users to interact with their alternatives in a parallel manner and interactively work with them. So advantages of these subjunctive interfaces is that they are easier for visual comparison and reasoning, and it enables the designer to make various alternatives in a shorter time. And it supports the creativity in the design process. So what my research group did to as a solution for this problem is making a system which name is hysteresis system. The hysteresis system, it's not just have the features of subjunctive interfaces. It also can, in this system, the designer can choose the parameters he likes in their previous designs and combine them and make lots and lots of alternatives out of them. So to test this interface, we had seven expert architects, and the task was redesigning here, the central city, a complex with mixed use, educational, retail, and office tower. And the independent variable was two systems. The participants used two systems and provided 10 alternatives out of it. And here there are the place, the selected parameters of the alternatives they made. They can enter it here. The Cartesian product will be produced by the system here. And they can go through this dialer and see the different alternatives the machine made for them. And these are the gallery which the user made for himself. So what I hypothesized here was that with this kind of system, we will have more visual pleasing alternative. But here we see that there is no evidence that this system will make more visual preferable alternatives. But all of the users which used this interface told that this features was really beneficial and helpful, but it was really hard to work with. So but for conclusion, I think, however my hypothesis was rejected, but there is still need for this kind of interfaces because it really saves the time of the architect, and it really makes a huge
amount of alternatives to go through and look. But we have to redesign the interface because it has lots of crashes, and we have to give the users more time to do the design because design can't be done in just a few minutes, and more participants should be there for the study to be valid. Thank you very much.
Hi everyone, my name is Stephanie Wong and my research is EZA assessing the usability of smartwatches to cheat in academic exams. First of all, I would like to acknowledge my supervisor, Instructor Bernhard and Carmen Newslater, and my fellow colleagues who have helped me do this research, Lillian, Amelia, Emily and Andrew. So, why would I want to do this? Firstly, I'm a user experience designer in wearable technologies, and what I found is that users perceive them as a cheating tool. That is concerning because that's what we are improving. And that is actually being banned from exams halls. So the problem is cheating has been going on since the 90s. And given the wearable technology is going to improve, academic dishonesty cannot be detected. Therefore, in the long term, we're going to have fake academic degrees as well as fake professionals. So you and I will be having doctors who are going to operate on us who have no idea what they're going to do. Having said that, the thing is that past researchers have actually tested that it's possible to cheat with smartwatches. The thing is, I want to know as a student and as a researcher is how effective, efficient, and usable is it to cheat with smartwatches. So would I be able to get correct answers if I did multiple choice questions with smartwatches or short answers? Or is the smartwatch good enough for picture or text if I would be able to do it in a shorter time span? Would I have to do more effort in terms of interacting with it based on those questions? Or would I have a more easier time and, you know, have lesser interaction or higher interaction if it's picture or text? Or is my perceived usability correct in terms of the picture or text mode? So these are my hypotheses. And so the next question is, what type of participants do I want to have? And what assessment has picture and text? This is easy because I'm TAing and I know that undergrads are easy to access. And that's the assessment. You need to know where the body parts are and what they're labeled. If you don't know, then that's a big no-no. So those are my demographics. I had 16 participants. I checked whether what their cheating history is. So we have a great number of people who have good positive cheating history. We have a pattern of two, so I checked whether they're international students or not, and if they are left-handed, right-handed. And two people actually had smartwatches. So how am I going to do this? I had designed a 2x2 factorial design. And this is, so my first independent variable is question type, where I measured the multiple choice question and short answers. And my information mode, which is picture and text, which is on the smartwatch. So I checked the task success rate based on the question type and at the time completion for the information mode. The interaction effort is how many times they tap or swipe. That is on the picture mode for both of them. And the usability metrics user experience, I measured for information mode. So those are my students, and I made them sit there, and I'm sitting in front of them, and I'm going to measure them. And I had the camera on top of it so that they could record. And my setup included having them do the informed consent, the case scenario, making or forcing them or whatever, trying to tell them how they could actually have the opportunity to cheat if they want. I gave them a smartwatch training of how to use the smartwatch, as well as where the materials they could find the answers. I asked them to do four tasks, which has multiple choice questions, short answers, picture, and text mode, and I would constantly look at them after 30 seconds for 1 minute. I give them the demographics and post-questionnaire after they finish doing that. So what I found is that there's no statistically significance for most of my hypotheses. There's no difference in time completion if you do picture or text. And it takes the same amount of effort to do multiple choice questions and short answers, as well as if you have the interaction effort is the same for picture and text. As you can see on this graph, which is the UMUX, and the picture and text has the same perceived usability. So that's one of my findings. But what I did find is my first hypothesis, which is task success rate for question, multiple choice question, and short answers is significant. Well, I did the Wilcoxon signed rank, but it's better to see it this way. So 57% of people actually was able to do the multiple choice questions without having prior knowledge of the material, being in the test situation, and also being able to cheat without being caught. So 43% of the students could not perform that well because they actually had to remember the difficult spellings, which was difficult for them. So what this means is that smartwatches are effective for cheating, but they're not efficient and usable, and they're effective for cheating for multiple choice questions. So banning policy, which academic institutes have perceived, is correct, and therefore, yes, every institute can do that. However, and then there's also the possibility of having smartwatch detectors or hiring more exam moderators, but that's not the permanent solution. What the permanent solution is that short answers and other formats, response formats, which requires the students to actually give an input, that should be researched and tested with other technologies. And ACI designers should actually find out more interaction and gesture codes for cheating. Thank you. Hold on to this one first.
Here is the slides. I guess you are in your folder.
Sure.
Thank you very much. Okay. Yes. Hello, everyone. Today we are going to talk about locomotion in virtual reality. Let me start about the basic concept. Usually, almost everybody knows that virtual reality is very cool, but the thing is usually the VR locomotion is challenging, so it's not very interesting. Usually researchers say that that's because of a problem usually called as queue conflict. It means that whenever you use, for example, the game controller to move in the environment, you will see yourself moving, so your eyes tells your brain that you're moving, but the other sensors in your body don't feel any acceleration force, so they tell your brain you are not moving, so your brain will be confused, and it can make you disoriented, so you will be lost in the environment, or you can be motion sickness. To solve this problem, VR researchers try to replace the game controllers with some sort of motion, physical motion interfaces. They are usually called natural locomotion interfaces. They try to provide some sort of physical motion cues for the
player or for the human to somehow deceive his mind as believe the mind that it is working. However, usually you can never buy this if you want to play a VR game in your house, because those are usually expensive. So I was interested to see if there is any way we can design some sort of simple physical motions to help people to enjoy their games. Currently, usually, currently people use the game controllers or the joystick to move in the games, both in non-VR and VR games, if they want to go the continuous locomotion. So I choose the joystick as the first condition, and I ask people to sit on a simple chair and use the joystick to move in my game. But then I thought probably it would be good to, for example, change the joystick with something else. Let me show you. Because almost everyone, many people have the swivel chair in their house. I thought probably they can sit down, and instead of rotating with joystick, they can rotate with their chair. So I added a wide controller at the back of the chair, and then people could sit there, and when they rotated physically, the wide controller detected the direction, and also I used the curve rod to hold the cable over the player head so they can rotate without entangling the cable around their neck. So that was my second interface, which is called real rotation. They move forward by joystick, by rotated by the chair. The third one, I thought, okay, if they can rotate by the chair, why they can move forward and backward by the chair? So they can lean back and forward to move forward with the chair, and I call this a swivel chair because almost all the swivel chair work like this. And as the last one, I thought, okay, probably we can add more physical motion, and they even can lean to the left and right to move toward this direction. To implement that, I use the rebalance board and put that beneath a chair. So these are not very expensive, like about $60. And then I compared all these four interfaces. The last one is funky chair because it's a little bit funky. And the whole experiment design is to first bring player into an introduction session to sense how their body feels, and then they have a free locomotion to go and rescue a person from a jail, and then they need to follow the person in the straight path, and they control their speed, and then they need to help this person to run in a spiral path to control their speed and direction to finally finish the game. But the results are very interesting. Usually in these types of games, you will see that many researchers compare joystick with RNA interface, and usually joystick is the best, joystick is very easy. But interestingly, in our interface, even we used something so far like 6 participants, but the joystick was only significantly better in terms of comfortable, so it was very comfortable. But for example, the real rotation has the lowest motion sickness, as you can see, at least from the funky chair. Joystick was not that much different, and real rotation was significantly more accurate than the joystick. Also, the swivel chair was significantly more accurate than the joystick in terms of following the path. Real rotation was easier to use and also has a longer usement. Also, for the swivel chair has the high enjoyment, so it's the only significant difference in the data, not the joystick, and also it is a very highly easy to learn. And for the funky chair has a higher sensation of self-motion, so the people really feel like they're moving, but it was not preferred like the other one, probably because of the motion sickness. So it seems that the real rotation and swivel chair are great, and you can use them if you want to play the game. These are better than joystick, but we need more participants to finish this experiment. That's it. Okay.
guess that's all right. Right? So this is Serkan, and that's my topic. So you got to know a few things before that. So what's binaural audio and what's spatial updating? About spatial updating, like, here's my 5 cents, literally, 5 cents. And, like, even though you were looking at your laptop and, like, you're watching this presentation in the video after a year or so, you can pretty much tell the coin landed somewhere there. So that's what spatial update is, you know, so you can tell the object is there in the 3D environment. So what is binaural audio then? Binaural audio is an audio rendering technique, so it tries to simulate the human hearing. So it provides, like, superior, like, 3D spatialization. So when you're, like, moving your head with the head-mounted display and stuff, you can sense that, like, the 3D environment, if it has a, like, 3D binaural audio source, it will update accordingly. But what it introduces is that, like, it introduces a computational load, so you need a encoder, decoder for that, and, like, you need a production, extra production burden is introduced, so you gotta have someone on board who can do the mixing and stuff. So we try to come up with a, you know, answer the question that does binaural audio would help us in a task which is like, which requires user to have, like, spatial updating in VR. So what's the catch about that? So you can tell, like, if you're designing a task which is, like, intensive in the spatial updating, you might want to tell, you know, whether, like, binaural audio would help you or not, or, like, it will help you in some setting, or, like, it might not help you if your goal is something else type of thing. So we try to measure multiple things, and in order to do that, we came up with this, like, really nice setup for, like, wildlife photography. So you're moving along this path with your, you know, virtual Jeep, and, like, you have prairie dogs around, and you have a spotlight at your head, and when they see you, they hide. And when they do not see your, like, spotlight, they start chirping, and, like, you're having, like, in two conditions. One is the binaural audio and one is the stereo audio. And I want to measure, like, the completion time. It's just I ask users to take 20 photos in one session, and the percent accuracy is that, like, number of times I hit, you know, my virtual camera, and, like, number of times I took a legitimate photo. And the vertical area and horizontal area, I'll talk about in a second. So this is the environment that I designed. So I'm just, like, a user surveying the virtual environment, and you see the prairie dogs, and you see the, when you get a legitimate shot, you see it in front of you. So, yeah, that's pretty much about the virtual environment and the game design. So the session time is, like, kind of obvious, and the percent accuracy, I talked about that. And vertical error, as you see, like, this is a photo that is actually taken by a subject during the experiment. So this is the center of the photo, and there is this, like, horizontal, and there is this vertical, you know, error, which is, like, normalized. And I'm trying to, you know, measure them. I measured them, and, like, I wanted to see, like, whether this has some difference in two settings. So, well, I offered them snacks and Burger King coupons. Unfortunately, nobody took those. And, like, I have this informed consent one and, like, pain lab swag. And, yeah, for the method parts, so this is to tell it's, like, counterbalance. So if the first person comes with the binaural, the second subject will be having the stereo first. So they will have training sessions in each settings, and they will have 20 photos in each settings between the sessions, and at the end of the sessions they will fill a questionnaire which is, like, derived from PQ and GQ, which is, like, game experience questionnaire and presence questionnaire, and this is, like, poor Ash trying to play the game. And I have this video which is like 2 times faster. I want to show like they're trying to actually, you know, update spatially when they are playing the game. And yeah, you see like they're spending some effort and stuff. And yeah, this is Yuli. And when they have controller in one hand, they tend to have it like put their hands in their pockets. Yeah, I'm running short on time, so I'm just going to preliminary results. So the accuracy did not change much. I had 8 subjects, so I'm still running the experiment. I have like 20 people on board by Monday. But yeah, this also like session time has some difference between stereo and binaural. And the vertical error, yeah, this obviously requires more subjects, and also this is the same for horizontal error. So I'm still, like, as in the experiment, looking for that thing with, like, more participants and stuff. So thank you for listening.
My name is Xintian. My topic is about spatial memory, which in my study is basically remember locations in digital display. Why spatial memory matters? I have 2 examples. First is the game. When we play games, sometimes we need to remember what was behind us. And also for maps, when we're hiking in mountains, sometimes it's hard to use digital navigation tools due to bad signal, and then we need to remember locations to avoid getting lost. My research questions. First, is plain gray background, pattern background, or background with reference block more helpful for people to remember locations? This question is related to a result from prior research. The result shows adding a perspective 3D background and the patterned wallpaper together, it would have a negative effect on the spatial memory. And I would like to see how the 2 factors work separately. And the second question is static. How do static and moving viewpoints affect on people's spatial memory? My experiment is within subject design. The first factor is 3 background, the gray one, the pattern one, and the reference block. The second is the 3 different types of viewpoints. The static viewpoints, the viewpoints of moving forward, backward, and the viewpoints moving from side to side. And the variable I measure is the number of correct answers from participants in each memorization task. In total, I have 13 participants. Most of them are students. Some of them have different jobs. For the procedure for each participant, the first step, they get familiar with objects and the background. And second, the participants work on 9 memorization tasks in a random sequence. And then finally, they finish a survey. for the memorization task, first participants need to look at a video of 24 seconds to remember the locations in the video. In total, there are 12 objects, and they just need to remember as many as they can. And afterwards, they look at the same background, but without the object, and they tell the examiner the locations they remember, and the examiner record and check the results if it's correct or not. So, results. The average number of correct answers shows that the reference block's background is most helpful for participants to remember locations. And repeated two-way ANOVA shows that the background has a significant effect on participants' spatial memory. And the viewpoints and the background cross the viewpoints, they don't have a significant effect. The survey results, however, shows a result somewhat different from the correct number of answers. Most of the participants prefer the reference blocks. It's same as expected in the correct number of results. And the 11 of 30, out of 13 participants prefer the static viewpoints. And it's a very obvious difference. But the viewpoint for the correct number of locations they remember is not significant. This is an interesting difference, and I think maybe further research can be worked on this. In conclusion, the reference box, the background, is helpful for is significantly helpful for remember locations, but the static viewpoint provides a better user experience. I hope this result can be useful for future game map and some other related app design. Thank you.
All right. Thanks again for all the speakers. And also, thanks very much for staying on time, and thanks for sticking around here. And I really appreciated teaching this course. It was a lot of interesting conversations, a lot of fun, and especially the engagements of the students in the different activities and helping each other out in difficult situations and playing devil's advocate games and supporting each other, and also wonderful TA Emily. So thanks again for everybody.